Mr. Justice Arijit Pasayat, Mr. Justice Ananga Patnaik, Mr. Justice Lalit, Chief Justice Muddidhar, Mr. Advocate General, dignitaries, ladies and gentlemen. It is extremely heartening to note that only 2 days ago, the Nobel Peace Prize was awarded to two journalists who had outstanding courage in nations which were not known for their press freedom, namely the Philippines and Russia. What was very disheartening was the fact that worldwide, the Philippines was placed as 138th out of 180 nations. We were placed at 142 and Russia was placed at 150. Despite the fact that India is known to be the world's largest democracy, why is this rating of our nation something which we should balk at? I believe that it has largely to do with outdated colonial laws and other repressive laws that have followed them in introducing what was called correctly by the Advocate General as the chief free speech. But out of Westminster in the UK, something which Edward I, an extremely powerful king in the UK, promulgated, contained a clause 34. Now, clause 34 said that if any false news is spread by the king's subjects, which drive a wedge between the king's subjects, then such false news is liable to be punished. The punishment will be as a mild one, where actually against then. Can you hear me and see me now?
Yes, sir. You are audible.
Yes. Can you see me as well?
No, sir. Your video is not coming. Your video is off.
Just a minute. Now is it on?
Yes, now it is perfect.
Yes, sir.
Sorry for the interruption. There's something wrong with the internet connection. We stopped at the point where Edward III has this Treason Act of 1331. Right. Yes.
Clause 34 you were referring to.
Yes. And after the Treason Act, what was important was that England matured as a democracy. And after it matured as a democracy, as you heard, the Advocate General told you that there was a commission set up in 1977 which recommended that sedition be abolished. And as a matter of fact, now in the mother country, it has been abolished in 2009, except for aliens. When we go to the US, which is again the world's oldest living constitution, which continues as such, very early in the Adams administration, we had a Sedition Act of 1798, which expired as a temporary measure in 1801. Nothing much happened so far as sedition is concerned until World War I, after which we had the Alien and Sedition Acts. And the Alien and Sedition Acts of 1918 then became the subject matter of several judgments of the US Supreme Court. A very important judgment is the judgment in Schenck's case. Now, Schenck was a person who belonged to the Socialist Party. In fact, he was the secretary of that party. And he printed 15,000 leaflets, which said that the draft was something that was not only illegal, but evil, that we should not go to war at all. And this he said at a stage when the United States was at war with several nations in World War I. Justice Holmes, celebrated Justice Holmes, writing for the court, spoke of the clear and present danger test, which was, and he gave a beautiful example, that suppose somebody were to shout fire in a crowded theater, obviously that would create a disruption of an enormous order and must be stopped instantly. But short of that, if there is no clear and present danger of anything untoward or illegal happening, free speech cannot be curbed. Shortly thereafter, in another judgment, in Abraham's case, this time, the judge found himself in a minority with the equally celebrated Justice Brandeis. Now, in Abraham's case, there were only 5 persons of Russian origin who also distributed leaflets saying pretty much the same thing that Schenck had said. The majority judgment convicted them following Schenck. Justice Holmes, however, said that these 5 gentlemen could not possibly have really rocked any boat in any real sense, as was pointed out by him in the Schenck judgment. And then spoke these words, which have passed into the literature of the law. It is so beautiful that I wish to read it out to you. Persecution for the expression of opinion seems to me perfectly logical. If you have no doubt of your premises or your power and want a certain result with all your heart, you actually express your wishes in law and sweep away all opposition. To allow opposition by speech seems to indicate that you think the speech important, as when a man says that he has squared the circle, or that you do not care wholeheartedly for the result, or that you doubt either the expression of opinions that we loathe and believe to be fraught with death, unless they're so imminently threatened immediate interference with the lawful and pressing purposes of the law that an immediate check is required to save the country. These words have since become classic and have often been quoted in several judgments all over the world. In the United States, following upon these judgments and following upon the repeal of this temporary measure, it was repealed in 1921. We find another very repressive measure in 1940, which was called the Smith Act, after a senator who was witch hunting communists. Several judgments occurred as a result of the Smith Act as well, the most notable being Dennis versus the United States, a 1951 judgment, in which quite regressively the US Supreme Court held that it was enough for somebody to say something or to abuse the government or the United States without intending any imminent lawless action. And that was enough to put the person either behind bars or to completely stop free speech. Yates versus the United States in 1957 did something to mitigate this, because it said, no, it must translate itself or must be thought to translate itself into some kind of disorder before you can stop free speech. And finally, in a Ku Klux Klan case, Brandenburg versus Ohio in 1969, the test laid down, which is followed till today, is that free speech cannot be curbed unless there is a proper perception as to imminent lawless action. How then did this great democracy get its Section 124, capital A? We come to the year 1835, a year in which the Governor General's in Council had a law member whose duty it was to frame certain statutes. The law member at that time was a genius called Lord Thomas Babington Macaulay. There's a famous story told of Macaulay when he was a four-year-old child. He was so precocious that when a lady dropped some coffee on him, he instantly shouted, and the lady said, "I hope you are all right, my child." His answer was, "Madam, the agony has abated." Now, it is this man who took 2 years to draft the enormous Indian Penal Code. Mind you, he was apologetic about drafting it, because he said, "I've taken 2 years, but don't forget, the Napoleonic Code took 8 years, from 1801 to 1808 and 1809 to draft. And the later Louisiana Code also took 4.5 years. So don't blame me for taking 2 years." However, from 1837, nothing much happened until the great Indian Mutiny took place in 1857. The Crown took over. And in 1860, for the first time, Macaulay's draft in large parts became the law as the Indian Penal Code. Strangely enough, the sedition section, which was clause 113 of that draft, didn't find any place in the code. This was discovered by James Fitzjames Stephen, who was largely responsible for our Evidence Act, in 1870. And Subhanu Peacock, who had largely redrafted parts of the code and reintroduced most of Macaulay's parts of the code, said somehow by oversight, this section, which was so important to British rule here, was overlooked. And so was born Section 124, capital A, in 1870. As the Advocate General told you, the section used peculiar language. It said attempts to excite disaffection. Disaffection was the term, to the government established by law. And the only exception was that acts of disapprobation would not amount to disaffection. Now, the first real case under which this particular section was used, and mind you, the sentences were enormous, because the sentence under 113, then translated into 124A, was transportation for life or anything lower. And if it was to be imprisonment, it was to be 3 years or anything lower. And the first real case which we need to notice in India is what is called the Bangobasi case in 1892. Now, the Bangobasi case took place because this particular journal, Bangobasi, which was a vernacular journal at that point, spoke against what was called the Age of Consent Act of 1891, the British Act, which tried to bring in curbs on child marriage. The editor tried to say, and in fact, the editor, one of the things pleaded by the editor was, this wasn't his article, but this was somebody else's article, which he only published. He tried to say that, look, not only am I not the author of the article and therefore not liable, but also basically all that I was trying to point out was that child marriage is something which is inherent in our law. And please don't be like the Emperor Aurangzeb, who tried to deal with us as if we were aliens. You will only alienate us. The British judge, Petharam, was not at all charmed by this argument, and therefore held the editor liable despite the fact that he had not written it. He said, the section doesn't say that you have to write. It's enough that you have attempted to excite disaffection by printing this. And he also ultimately summed up by saying, and which was really the law until our Supreme Court judgment, that there is no part that any disorder or leading to disorder, there's no part that disorder plays in sedition. In short, sedition is if you are a person who says that the government of the day is something which must be brought down, it is enough that you say it, and that itself constitutes sedition without more, because what you are doing is exciting disaffection, that is disloyalty against that government. 5 years later, three other very interesting judgments are given by the Indian courts. The first is in the celebrated first Bal Gangadhar Tilak trial. Now, Tilak ran two vernaculars. One was the Kesari and one was the Maratha, through which he spoke. And here he spoke about the famine that had caused plague and ultimately that had caused British collectors, etc., unnecessarily interfering with the rights of Indian citizens by entering their homes at any point without warrant and trying to see whether plague was spreading or wasn't spreading. Now, the unfortunate part was that the articles that were printed in the Kesari were printed on 15 June of that year. And a week later, on 22nd June, somehow or the other, they put the articles together with the incident that happened on 22nd June, which was that a particular youth went and shot the collector dead, Rand, and one other person. And Tilak was then tried for sedition. Interestingly, Sir Dinsha Davar, who became the judge who tried him in the second case, was in the defense team. The defense team at that point could get no British barrister from Bombay. So Rabindranath Tagore was called to organize two British barristers from Calcutta who came and who defended Tilak. Finally, the judge summed up rather strongly and made it earlier, there is no need for disorder to result. It is enough that you have said something against the government of the day and therefore excited disaffection. And disaffection was said to be something which is the absence of affection, disloyalty, etc. Tilak was sentenced to 18 months. But at the instance of persons like Dadabhai Nauroji, Hunter, Max Muller, etc., the British government released him within about a year, 51 weeks. The second important trial of that time was what was called the Satara trial or the Pathod trial. Pathod was again a particular vernacular in which the editor this time spoke of wanting Swaraj or independence. And here again, the editor who was tried and sentenced, given the same kind of reasoning as Justice Petharam earlier and the second learned judge later. The third important case took place in Allahabad with Chief Justice Edge. And there was a Muslim daily, which apparently printed the same thing and said that we want independence from you. And the editor apologized. But despite the apology was not accepted. The editor was given 18 months in jail. These three judgments led to an amendment of Section 124 capital A in 1898. And the amendment was twofold. One was it added certain explanations with which we are not directly concerned. But what it did was, importantly, to state that disaffection now included disloyalty. So we were left basically at square one because we didn't know what disaffection meant. And now disloyalty equally was the vague term. So it is enough that you are disloyal. And of course, it added that there should be some hatred or contempt towards the government of India. But then that doesn't really help when you still have disaffection in the statute. Disaffection was not removed from the statute. Now, given these amendments, we come now to the second Tilak trial in 1909. And this second Tilak trial, which took place again in Mumbai, took place when certain articles were written about a certain magistrate who was to travel in a particular carriage. He didn't in fact travel in that carriage, but some lawyer's wife and daughter traveled in that carriage. And so the persons who threw a bomb into the carriage really killed an innocent lady or two innocent ladies, the wife and the daughter, and not the hated magistrate. Tilak wrote about how throwing bombs is not something that should be tolerated, but at the same time said that, look, if you mistreat a cat, then at some time it is bound to pounce upon its master. And Tilak then also made certain incendiary remarks against the British government of the day and said that ultimately, don't forget, a bomb is something like an amulet. It's an amulet which a proud Indian wears around his neck in order to get rid of rule which otherwise suffocates it. This time, as I told you, Dinsha Davar happened to be the judge, not the person who defended. The person who defended him was none other than Muhammad Ali Jinnah. And again, strangely enough, bail was refused by Justice Ranade in the first round, but granted by Justice Badruddin Tayabji later. Ultimately, in the second Tilak trial, Tilak defended himself for 21 hours. Can you imagine? Over a long period, made long speeches. And finally, the judge summed up very strongly against him. And the jury sentenced him to 6 years of transportation, which he served out in Mandalay. In the same year, 1909, another trial took place, this time of Ganesh Savarkar. And Savarkar quoted from some 4 poems, in which again he made it plain that there is a foreign yoke that has to be thrown off. Savarkar got a very severe sentence, which is transportation for life. He landed up in the Andamans. In 1916, we now have a third Tilak trial. This time it was not under 124 capital A, but it was under section 108 of the CRPC. 108 is a sort of anticipatory provision which says that we will take security from you if we think that you are going to make incendiary remarks or speeches. And that bail bond will be a huge amount so that you stay out of trouble for a period of at least 1 year. Fortunately for him this time, he was tried by a magistrate, of course, who convicted him. But in appeal, he succeeded before Justices Batchelor and Lallubhai Shah. Batchelor happened to be an English judge who spoke Gujarati. There's a very interesting thing said about Justice Batchelor. Apparently, he went into a Bombay bus and there were 3 Parsi ladies who said, I suffered udar under Ayoch, which means this white rat has entered. When he got off at the station, he said, my safed udar ave nikrech. And they were absolutely in consternation because the safed udar understood every word that this English gentleman said. But anyway, third time round, he was lucky and he was acquitted of the charge of having to give this huge security deposit under section 108 of the CRPC. Shortly thereafter, this was the year 1916, as I told you. In 1919, certain cataclysmic events took place. All of you know that on 13th of April, Jallianwala Bagh took place. Equally, in 1919, what was called the Rowlatt Act was then passed. Now, the Rowlatt Act was a very repressive measure. It was basically a measure which sought to continue a wartime emergency measure, such as was contained in the Defense of India Act at the time. There was no commitment before trial. There was no right to a lawyer. There was no appeal given to you. So it was almost sure shot that whatever was put against you would be proved against you and you'd be in jail for a long period. The third thing that happened was the famous Khilafat movement, that after World War I, the Sultan of Turkey was deposed. The Ottoman Empire of 600 years came to an end. But at the same time, the British promised certain things to Turkey, which they didn't carry up. Now, thanks to each one of these 3 things, namely Jallianwala Bagh, the Rowlatt Act, and finally, the Sultan of Turkey being thrown out, Gandhiji started a major civil disobedience movement. The strange part is that whenever violence took place, he called it off. And he called it off twice. But despite the fact that he called it off twice, he was tried for sedition. And the judge who tried him, Broomfield, had no option, because in young India, the editor was a man called Shankarlal Banker, who was also tried with him. Four articles clearly said, it is your duty to be disaffectionate to a foreign government. So it was very clear that this was within the act of Section 124 as it then stood. Gandhiji then, when called upon for his defense, important statement which has to be made in full. Can you hear me now?
Yes, sir. You are audible.
Yes. I was stopped at the stage where Gandhiji was going to make his famous statement before Judge Broomfield in 1922. And this is the statement that he made. Section 124 capital A, under which I am happily charged, is perhaps the prince among the political sections of the Indian Penal Code, designed to suppress the liberty of the citizen. Affection cannot be measured or regulated by law. If one has no affection for a person or system, one should be free to give the fullest expression to his disaffection, so long as he does not contemplate, promote, or incite to violence. But the section under which Mr. Banker and I are charged is one under which mere promotion of disaffection is a crime. I have studied some of the cases tried under it, and I know that some of the most loved of India's patriots have been convicted under it. I consider it a privilege, therefore, to be charged under that section. I have endeavored to give, in their briefest outline, the reasons for my disaffection. I have no personal ill will against any single administrator, much less can I be said to have any disaffection toward the king's person. But I hold it to be a virtue to be disaffectionate towards a government which in its totality has done more harm to India than any previous system. India is less manly under the British rule than she ever was before. Holding such a belief, I consider it a sin to have affection for the system. And it has been a precious privilege for me to be able to write what I have in the various articles tendered in evidence against me. Gandhiji was convicted for the same term as Tilak in the second trial. He got 6 years. But the British government let him out after he served about 2 of those years. Our first Prime Minister, Jawaharlal Nehru, also suffered under this law. Twice in 1930 and 1934, given the speeches that he made, he was incarcerated in jail and let out a little earlier. The stage becomes set now for the famous federal court judgment in Niharendru Dutt's case. In 1942, Niharendru Dutt was apprehended for making certain speeches which were undoubtedly disaffectionate to the government of the day. And what he argued finally succeeded in the federal court, Chief Justice Guyer speaking for the federal court. Chief Justice Guyer, mind you, was an English. He said at the heart of sedition in England, and we have to read 124 capital A in its English backdrop. So at the heart of sedition in England is the fact that this kind of thing must ultimately lead not only merely to disaffection to the government, but to public disorder. And it is only if it also leads to public disorder that a person can be booked under the section. This salutary reading of the provision didn't last, because in Bhale Rao's case in 1947, the Privy Council overruled this judgment. It pointed out that the word sedition was not used in 124 capital A at all. It was only in the marginal note. And it is well settled in law that a marginal note cannot control the plain language of the section. The plain language of the section said nothing about public disorder or violence, and therefore mere disaffection to the government of the day was good enough. It's at this stage that we finally throw off the shackles of our colonial masters, get freedom, and the Constitution of India now comes into force. The important point to remember is Article 19(1)(a), which guarantees the right of freedom of speech and expression, now comes into force for the first time. The only way in which speech can be curtailed is under Article 19(2), which at the very beginning did not contain the words public order. It contained several other things, including security of state. But unless you came within any of the subject matters of Article 19(2), freedom of speech could not be curtailed. Therefore, two very early decisions of our Supreme Court, in Romesh Thapar's case and in Brijbhushan's case, the first being where the editor of a magazine called Crosswords was not able to sell his magazine in Madras Presidency because of a particular act. And Brijbhushan, the editor of Organizer, an RSS weekly, had to undergo what was called censorship before the article could be published. Now, both sections were struck down. The court noticed that sedition had not been used in Article 19(2). In fact, the Constituent Assembly debates are very interesting because sedition did appear in the first draft. It was removed by Sardar Vallabhbhai Patel in the first draft at the instance of Somnath Lahiri, who was a CPI member of the Constituent Assembly. It crept up in the second draft as well, and this time it was removed because of vociferous attacks upon sedition by K.M. Munshi and certain others. So we find that the expression sedition is not there in 19(2) at all. And the court noticed this, ultimately said that at the heart of our democracy is free political discussion. Unless this can take place, out goes these particular sections, and it struck down Section 9 of the Madras Act and Section 7 of the East Punjab Act, as a result of which Crosswords could be sent to Madras and no pre-censorship was required so far as Organizer was concerned. Shortly after these judgments, an amendment was made with retrospective effect to Article 19(2). And this time they didn't add the word sedition. They added the words public order. They also added the words reasonable restrictions. So a restriction, there was now a balancing act that had to be done. Earlier there was no such balancing act. So that if free speech was involved and the state could point out that it fell within one of the categories mentioned in 19(2), and in addition it was a reasonable restriction, the balancing act, then free speech could be curtailed. Now, very early, Master Tara Singh's case in the Punjab High Court followed the Supreme Court judgments, said that there is no public order, etc., and said sedition is a colonial law which cannot stand muster under our new constitution, and struck down Section 124 capital A. The Patna High Court, however, held a different view, saying that now Romesh Thapar and Brijbhushan were no longer good law because public order had now been added. The Manipur High Court held something in between and said, yes, it is good provided it does not lead to incitement by violence, etc. And a full bench of the Punjab High Court in 1958, despite the fact that there was the Patna High Court to the contrary, also struck down 124 capital A, saying it was a colonial law which had no place in our laws after the constitution came into force. The stage was now set for a showdown in the Supreme Court. And the Supreme Court in Kedarnath's case, you had one case which came up from Bihar and three which came up from UP. And ultimately, after going through the entire gamut of the judgments, the law, the English law on sedition, etc., the court gave four reasons, which I'll come to a little later, and ultimately said that if we can read a particular provision in a particular way, as the federal court read it, namely that so long as disaffection to the government of the day is accompanied by an attempted incitement to violence or disorder, it would be good. So ultimately in 1962, the section stood, though it was a colonial law that had been misused often and continues to be misused. Now, post 1962, we had two wars. We had the China War, we had the Pakistan War of 1965, as a result of which another draconian measure comes into force, which is the Unlawful Activities Act of 1967. And here under Section 2O, an unlawful activity is defined for the first time as various things, including security of state, but also defined as having disaffection to India. Now, this was a big leap forward because it wasn't merely to the government of the day. In short, a distinction was made to the state, that is India as a concept, as a country, and the government of the day. However, despite having made this distinction, disaffection continues in the statute book. And it is a very draconian act because you have a minimum 5-year sentence leading up to life imprisonment. Also, you don't have anticipatory bail. And if bail is to be granted, then all that prosecution needs to show is a prima facie case against you. Now, this act again has not yet come under the scanner in any real way. And like the sedition section under 124 capital A will have to be looked into, given the great advances made in the law in the subsequent judgments after 1962. So from the Unlawful Activities Act, we come now to 1971, where there is a Law Commission report. The Law Commission report suggests various changes, suggests that 124A be brought in line with the federal court line of reasoning, also suggests that there be a broad basing of disaffection, not merely to the government of the day, but also to various institutions, which would include the national flag, the constitution, etc., etc. Now, of course, this Law Commission report was never actually enacted into law, so that it remains a dead letter. In 1976, we had Article 31D, which introduced anti-national activities. But then 31D also was repealed by the 44th Amendment. So that again didn't take us very, very far. The new CRPC in 1973, as was told to you by the Advocate General, now made the offense a cognizable one, which means the police could arrest you now without warrant, which again is a very serious thing. Now, given all this and given this baggage and background, in 1995 and 97, the Supreme Court acted proactively, but since there were smaller benches, they had to actually follow the 1962 judgment, but ultimately acquit persons who were caught under the sedition section. Private members' bills were also moved in 2011-2015, one to do away with sedition altogether, and one to try and bring in the federal court concept that you must have disorder along with it. Neither went any further. So then finally now, we are left with this colonial law and we are left with this judgment which upholds Section 124 capital A. The first important thing now is to note the reasons given in the 1962 Constitution bench judgment. There are four of them. The first reason given is that the expression used in Article 19.2 is in the interest of. So it can be a reasonable restriction in the interest of public order. In the interest of is a loose, elastic expression. So there need be no proximate relation to public order. It's good enough that there is some relation, albeit indirect. This won't stand muster today because somehow or the other, the court missed Ram Manohar Loya's judgment, which was a 1960 judgment before 62, also of our constitutional day, which explained the judgment in Virendra, which held this loose kind of concept and said that no, in the area of free speech, in the interest of is something that must be proximate. So that's the first reason. The second reason given is, read the section as a whole. If you read the section as a whole, it is obvious that the section not only attempts to grab people who make speeches, but attempts to grab people who incite others to violence. Now, here again, however you read the section has nothing whatsoever about violence. The Privy Council correctly said, sedition is a concept, which may be a concept in English law, but you go by the statute here. And the statute here says nothing about violence. It's enough that there is disaffection or disloyalty to the government established by law. Therefore, this is again something that needs looking into. The third reason given is a very peculiar reason. Please see Hayden's case, a 1584 judgment, and apply what is called the mischief rule. Now, if you are to apply the mischief rule, it is a section that has been set up expressly by a colonial master in order to suppress free speech in a colony. If you are to apply the mischief rule, then what happens is that the moment you apply the mischief rule, out comes the colonial law in all its glory and then grabs the Indian citizen after Article 19(1)(a). Hayden's case, therefore, has nothing to do with this. And the fourth reason given is equally peculiar, that if there is a literal reading also of the provision, please read it down. Any number of our judgments have held after 1962, that reading down cannot mean reading in, so that you cannot read the words violence, etc., into section 124A to possibly save it. Now, apart from these, there are two other very, very important judgments which have now come. One is in Shreya Singhal, where 66 capital A of the Information Technology Act has been struck down. This judgment holds two things very clear. Whether you discuss something or whether you advocate something, free speech covers you completely. It only goes out if there is a reasonable apprehension as to incitement to either an offense or to violence. And the second thing it lays down, and that is even more important, the chilling effect that you have on free speech. Now, if you are booking persons, including journalists, under this provision, the chilling effect that it will have on free speech is enormous, because people will not speak their minds. They know they're going to be booked. And if they are booked, both under this and under the Unlawful Activities Prevention Act, anticipatory bail is out. And there are large sentences which await them. So, to conclude, even the Shaira Bano case would show that manifest arbitrariness is now a ground which you can take, saying that a colonial law is now being brought to oppress a free citizen. So I would exhort the Supreme Court, and there is a live case before it, not to keep sending the case back to government, because governments will come, governments will go, and it's not government's business to start amending or repealing laws. The important thing to do is for you to use your powers and strike down the law. If you strike down 124A and you strike down the offensive parts of the Unlawful Activities Prevention Act, the citizen here can breathe more freely. And maybe this country will move from 142 out of 180 to something much higher. Thank you all very much.
Thank you so much, sir, for such an enlightening and insightful lecture. It is always an awestruck moment listening to your erudite speeches. And I am sure that everyone listening to you today or who will listen to this in future will certainly take something back home relating to sedition. You are a guiding star and leading light for countless law students and law professionals. We are really indebted to your presence and eloquent speech. Thank you. Thank you so much, Roynton, sir. Now,